think of someone closest to God or the most spiritual person that you know, who comes to your mind, right? And if it's yourself, then you probably need to work on a little bit of humility, right? But as we think about who's closest to, there's one guy that I think throughout all the major religions, they would say he is up there, and his name's Moses. Right? So if you're a Christian, if you're Jewish, if you're Muslim, if you're other religions that believe in the prophets, then you think Moses is like up there. He's top one, definitely top three for most religions in the world as far as being spiritual. And today we're going to be talking a little bit about Jesus being better than Moses. It's interesting because in our country and in Christian America, right, what it used to be called anyway, Moses is still very influential. I read a book a couple years ago called America's Prophet, and it was all about the influence of Moses and his leadership in the leadership of our country. And some of the things that were said about it was the Pilgrims quoted his story. Franklin and Jefferson proposed he appear on the U.S. seal. Do you know that our seal was very close to being a picture of Moses and not the eagle there? Washington and Lincoln were called his incarnation. Martin Luther King Jr. invoked him the night before he died. Ronald Reagan and Barack Obama cited him as inspiration. Harriet Tubman is known as the Black Moses, right? I mean, he's a guy that's influenced our country for 400 years. And this may be the most important one, My favorite superhero, Superman, was modeled after Moses. Do you guys know that? Anybody know that? I mean, if you have another favorite superhero, hopefully this changes you to the light side here. But Superman was created by two Jewish men, and a lot of his life compares to Moses. He was sent out to be saved from destruction, and that's what happened with him on the river in Exodus. If you're going to go read a lot about Moses' life, his name in Kryptonian is El, which is in Hebrew is God. I mean, there's a lot of comparisons that you'll see that he came out of that. So the greatest superhero ever, right? Yes, right? Some of you need to be learned on your superheroes, all right? But in the midst of that, in the midst of America having a high view of Moses, it ills in comparison to what these that the author is writing to in Hebrews chapter 3, it ills in comparison to what they think of Moses. I mean, there was like God, and then there was like Moses, and sometimes it would be like that, right? And so he's writing to these ones that thought so much of Moses. I mean, he had done so much for them. He was the guy. He was their MVP of their Judaism. He was everything. And so when he's coming and saying Jesus is better than Moses, it's a pretty big task that he is trying to accomplish to make sure they understand, hey, who you have in you as Jesus Christ, Lord and Savior, is way better than Moses. And no disrespect to Moses, but let's read these first six verses in Hebrews chapter 3. Therefore, holy brothers and sisters who share in the heavenly calling, fix your thoughts on Jesus, whom we acknowledge as our apostle and high priest. He was faithful to the one who appointed him, just as Moses was faithful in all God's house. Jesus has been found worthy of greater honor than Moses, just as the builder of a house has greater honor than the house itself. For every house is built by someone, but God is the builder of everything. Moses was faithful as a servant in all God's house, bearing witness to what would be spoken by God in the future. But Christ is faithful as the Son over God's house. And this last part, we're going to talk a little bit about us, right? And we are his house, if indeed we hold firmly to our confidence in the hope in which we glory. Now, it was written to them there, but we can glean wisdom and knowledge for how to live our lives accordingly. So as we walk through this, he's addressing Christians, right? The author of Hebrews, remember, we don't know who that is, and somebody would say, well, it's God, and yes, God inspired everything and got everybody to write what he wanted them to write, but we don't know the human author that penned it for God. And so what the author is trying to do is to make sure everybody knows that Jesus is better than their God. So he addresses Christians who are headed to heaven. He says, fix your thoughts or consider Jesus. Make sure what you do and what you think is focused on Jesus. That's important. And he talks about the duality of Jesus as the apostle and the high priest. Now, a lot of times when we hear Jesus as an apostle, we'd be like, no. Jesus had apostles. He wasn't an apostle. And as you go through the Gospels, he did have apostles there. But the word apostle basically means sent one. The sent one. And so Jesus had 12 that he sent out, And so Jesus is the sent one from the Father that came to bring salvation. And then high priest, we're going to talk about this more in Hebrews a little bit later, but high priest is that mediator, that intercessor between God and man, and Jesus becomes that as Moses was in the Old Testament in a lot of ways. Jesus is now our high priest and our apostle sent from God. And then it says, talking about the house of God, that's referencing God's people. It's not a building. And still today, God doesn't reside in a building. He resides in the people of himself that are found with the Holy Spirit within them. We'll talk about that. But he is found worthy of more honor than Moses. And so what he's talking about here is a scale, right? The weighing scale. Maybe you put bananas or apples in a weighing scale at a store, and that's how much you pay according to that. But here's this scale, and the author is saying Jesus is way more worthy. Jesus is greater than Moses, and he wants to make sure they understand that. But this author has a high, high view of Moses. Matter of fact, this is the only time in the New Testament where this word is used on servants. It's a different word than the usual word for servant, and it's a therapon in Greek, which means the elevated servant, like the servant that's above other servants. Right? Maybe you've seen this in a show or a movie or a book. Any Downton Abbey fans in here? Right? So it'd be Mr. Coulson, right? That was a terrible English accent, I know that, but that was Mr. Coulson, right? So that would be him. Or if you're not quite as enlightened as myself and you think Batman's a superhero, it would be like Alfred to Bruce Wayne, right? He's not part of the house, but he's over everybody. And this is the word that's used for Moses here. And then we see that those that are in Christ are in his family, his household, but there's this big word there that we're going to talk about. If we hold firmly to the hope in which we glory. We're going to talk about what that means here in just a few minutes. But there's two things about Moses and Jesus we're going to look at, and then we're going to look at a couple things that you and I can glean from this, as well as how we honor the family. First thing, Moses was faithful, Jesus is more faithful. Excuse me. Moses is faithful, Jesus is more faithful, right? It's that balanced scale. Jesus is more faithful there. Moses was faithful to God. I don't know if you've read his life story, but he was pretty darn faithful, all right? You read in Exodus, tells a lot about his, which by the way, Moses wrote Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, and some Psalms, and it was passed down, some stuff was passed down, but you find out about his life in Exodus, and he was faithful. He was saved, and he actually was saved by Pharaoh's daughter when Pharaoh was trying to kill all the sons that were born, and he grew up in Pharaoh's household, and for about 40 years he's there. And then he saw some Egyptians that had enslaved the Israelites, an Egyptian that was mistreating Israelites, and Moses took matters in his own hand, not recommending this, but he killed the person, and then Pharaoh was after him, and he ran, and for 40 years he's in the desert, gets married, has kids, is a shepherd. I mean, he's kind of living the good life from 40 to 80, and about 80 years old, God says, I've got something for you. And at 80 years old, when he should be golfing and fishing, right? If he can still do that. Any 80-year-olds in here? Over 80? Maybe it's too hard for you to raise your hand, all right? But, you know, so when he should be doing that, he is called to lead God's people out of slavery. And then they're an obstinate people. They don't believe God. And so they have to wander in the desert for 40 years. So Moses is very faithful. He's delivered the law to them. He was a foreshadowing of Christ. People might understand their deliverer. In Exodus chapter 40, verse 16, it says, Moses did everything just as the Lord commanded him. Well, wouldn't that be a great one-line epitaph that you could have? When your life ends, what they say is this. Jeff did everything just as the Lord commanded him. Wouldn't that be great? I think that could be on my headstone there in my grave, except you'd have to cross off everything. Jeff did some things as the Lord commanded him. But that's what it says about Moses. There was even a time where Moses' siblings, Aaron and Miriam, Aaron was the high priest, and Miriam, she had a lot, she was a prophetess, and they get a little upset because Moses gets all the credit, and they're like, you know, we're not chopped liver around here, and they say some bad things about Moses. And God says, hey, let me take you to the woodshed here. Why don't you step out of the tent? And so Moses, Aaron, and Miriam step out, and God says this. He's talking to them, and he says, "But this is not true of my servant Moses. He is faithful in all my house. With him I speak face to face clearly and not in riddles. He sees the form of the Lord. Why then were you not afraid to speak against my servant Moses?" And if you know the end of that story, which I encourage you to go read as well, it doesn't always end well when you stand up against God's faithful one. I don't know if you'll find someone more faithful in Scripture. We see a lot about his life in 120 years. Now, he messed up a few times in the 40 years in the desert. He messed up a couple times, but there's days where I mess up a couple times in 40 minutes. Anybody else there? Every single one of you should have your hand up right now, unless you're over 80, all right? But I'm kidding. I have total respect for those that are there. Man, some of you over 80 are better than me in a lot of ways. Well, probably in all ways, but I digress. Let me get back to the passage here. It says, Jesus is more faithful than that. He never messed up, right? He's the perfect representation of obedience to God. He's a perfect example for us to see. He's so faithful. At the end of his life, he knows it's coming. And in John 17, he has this prayer where he prays to God about his relationship and his what he had done. Then he prays for the apostles. And then he prays for all those who would come after them, which includes us at the end of John 17, which is really cool. But in the first part where he's praying and he's talking to the Father, he says this in John 17, verse 4, "I have brought you glory on earth by finishing the work you gave me to do." I've been faithful with what I was given. I've been faithful to do what you called me to do. He was faithful even when it wasn't easy. Some of us in here have gone through tough times. Some of us have gone through a lot of pain. Some of us have lost loved ones. Some of us have had things happen to us financially, spiritually, emotionally, physically. Just was texting with a family dealing with a serious cancer just yesterday. Was talking, I can't even understand or fathom what they're walking through. And yet, in the midst of everything you've gone through, I'm not trying to make light of it, but I am saying Jesus suffered more because he went and he took all the sins of the world on himself when he was innocent of everything, and he knew what was coming, where the wrath of God was going to be satisfied on him on the cross, and Jesus was faithful to do it. But yet in Matthew 26, this was after the John 17 prayer, Jesus is praying. He asked some guys, he said, "Man, I'm overwhelmed, come pray with me." And then he prays in verse 39, "My Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me, yet not as I will, but as you will." That's faithfulness. Faithfulness doesn't mean you always get it. Faithfulness doesn't mean that you agree with it. Faithfulness means that you do it regardless. And that should be a mantra for all of us to understand if we're truly a Christ follower, it's not my will, but your will be done in my life. And Jesus demonstrated that for us. He was an example of faithfulness, even overcoming temptation. Last week, we talked about this just a second in Hebrews 2:18, where it says, "Because he himself suffered when he was tempted, he is able to help those who are being tempted." Jesus knew what it was like to be tempted and to overcome, and he gave us the example of it. He overcame temptation every way. He was faithful, 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 more faithful than Moses. He's even faithful today, showing up in all sorts of ways. I was reading this story with the ministry that we support here, and I love. It's called the Jesus Film Project, and there was a story that came out of Cambodia. In the late 70s, it's when the Marxist rebels were killing thousands and thousands of people in the killing fields in 75 through 79. And there was a family that was trying to escape from Cambodia to Thailand, and they're running, and they go into the jungle, and they get lost in the jungle. And while they're in the jungle, they don't know what they're going to do, and all of a sudden, a man shows up and says, "I know the way. I know the way. Follow me." And so they said, okay, so they followed him. And he takes them across the border, gets them to Thailand, to a refugee camp. And they're turning around to thank him, and they look, and he's gone. And so they're like, "Well, we're safe. This is good." And a few days later, the Jesus Film Project showed up there, and they set up their big projector, and they showed the movie. And in the midst of them showing the movie, the first time Jesus comes on the screen, all those that were lost in the jungle start pointing to the screen. "That's the man. That's who met us in the jungle and led us out to safety." And no, it wasn't the actor who played Jesus in the movie that just happened to be in the jungle in Cambodia. It was Jesus showing up in a form that they could recognize. We need to listen to this And many of them came to faith in Christ because of that. And God shows up like that. Jesus is showing up in dreams and visions all around the world. I mean, you just heard about FAM and what's going on in India. There's such a move of God in India and other places where they try to press down on Christians, and yet God shows up. He's faithful, and it's amazing to see what Jesus is doing. But Jesus is more faithful than Moses. Let's get back to that. And then the second part, Moses was the servant. Jesus is the son. Moses served God and did what he asked of him almost all the time, right? The author of Hebrews even goes on a little bit and brags on Moses in chapter 11 in the faith chapter, which we'll be covering in September. But he says, by faith, Moses, when he had grown up, refused to be known as the son of Pharaoh's daughter. He chose to be mistreated along with the people of God rather than to enjoy the fleeting pleasures of sin. He regarded disgrace for the sake of Christ as of greater value than the treasures of Egypt because he was looking ahead to his reward. By faith, he left Egypt, not fearing the king's anger. He persevered because he saw him who is invisible. By faith, he kept the Passover and the application of blood so that the destroyer of the firstborn would not touch the firstborn of Israel. And that's the 10th plague in Exodus, if you go read that. See, the author is not discrediting Moses at all. As a matter of fact, he's elevated him and said, man, he was a servant. He was faithful. But he is not the son. He is no Jesus. Moses delivered the word of God, but Jesus is the word of God. And the author wanted to make sure they understood that. Right? If you remember in Isaiah 7:14, this was 700 years before Jesus was born, the prophecy was said, therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son and will call him Emmanuel. Right? So 700 years before Jesus even comes to earth, that is prophesied. And you guys remember for 15 points, what does Emmanuel mean? God with us. Right? And so here you have Moses was a servant, but Jesus is the son, God with us. Jesus himself in John 8:35 says, now a slave has no permanent place in the family, but a son belongs to it forever. And you know what's so cool about that? A son belongs to it forever. It's that Jesus is the son, and he invites all of us to be part of the family. He invites all of us to be sons and daughters so that we will be part of the family forever. Right, and so we're going to talk a little bit about that. So then now what? We're going to come away from those two things we see, Moses and Jesus, and say, what do we do? How do we respond to this? Well, first of all, we need to join the family. And when I say join the family, I say you're part of the family of God. And that there's two big titles that we always give to Jesus. And we just saw a few minutes ago as we saw someone say, yes, I'm in with Jesus. It was such a beautiful picture of Aiden up there. And so here it is. Jesus is Savior, right? He saves me. He saves me from what I deserve. Serve. And that's so important for us to understand this new birth into Christ. And in John 3:16, you might have heard that verse before, or you might have seen it at a football game or something like that. But John 3:16 is one of the most well-known verses there is out there. But 17 and 18 are really important for us to understand some context of what Jesus is saying. And in 3:16 through 18, he says, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. John 3:16 is excellent, but 17 and 18 make it even more excellent, that we would understand that Jesus came not to condemn the world. He didn't come to say, Jeff, you're a loser. You don't deserve to be with God. He came to say, Jeff, I love you and I want you to be with God. So he made a way through the cross and the empty grave. That's a beautiful thing. He didn't come to condemn the world, but to save the world. Why? Why do we need saved? Well, if you've been around Riverlawn, you hear this every single week, but it should never get old to us. We need saved because you and I have sin that needs to be paid for. We've sinned against God. We've sinned against others. We've sinned against ourselves. And in order to be in relationship with God, that sin has to be taken away. And yet we can't take it away. I mean, back in the old days, they have to sacrifice things, but it was never good enough. They always had to do more, do more, do more, do more. And God made a final way in Jesus, say he's the ultimate sacrifice. And so for the payment for sin, it's either death, which is hell, where we deserve to go, where we deserve to be. And that's not why Jesus came to say, go to hell. Jesus came to say, I want you to be with me in heaven. And so he gives a way for that sin to be paid for, not by going to hell, but by his death on the cross. Sin had to be covered by death. And that's why Jesus had to die. That's why he took your sins, my sins, sins of the world on him. And all those who receive him and repent of their sins and follow after him they will receive eternal life and their sins are forgiven. If you've never done that, we would encourage you to text the word follow to the number on the screen. We'd love to talk to you about that, or come down and talk to someone after service down here. We'd love to tell you a little bit about what that looks like. Right? We're not baptized into the name of Moses. We're not baptized into the name of David. We're not baptized into the name of Riverlawn Christian Church or some sort of denomination. We're baptized into the name of Jesus. We are his. He is Savior for us. In Romans 6:3, Paul writes, "Or don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life." That's this beautiful picture that God gives us, that we die to ourselves, and Jesus, he was in the tomb, then raised new life. We too go into this watery grave. We've said yes to Jesus. We've received this wonderful gift, and we're raised to life in Christ. It's this new identity. As Jesus was talking to Nicodemus in John 3, he says, "You must be born again." Right? It's a spiritual birth, and it's this picture of us being born again after we die to ourselves. A beautiful thing. He makes us part of a family, the house of God. We are sons and daughters. There's no other way to be part of God's family. Coming to church doesn't make you part of God's family. Reading your Bible doesn't make you part of God's family. Giving money to the church doesn't make you part of God's family. Saying yes to Jesus as your Savior and Lord makes you part of God's family. Repenting of your sins and committing to him. But then there's something else that we see that we can learn from Moses that I think we need to have if we do become a part of the family of God. We got that Savior part, which is the easy part for us, right? Because Jesus did all the heavy lifting. But then it comes to us having heavy lifting, and that's where we're to stay faithful to the family. And this is the part where we say Jesus is Savior, but he's also Lord, right? Lord means boss, ruler, master. Lord means we surrender to you, we submit to you. We let him lead the family. We're to be faithful like Moses as part of our family. I tell you, I have a 15-year-old boy with Down syndrome. He doesn't talk all that great. And he doesn't always make, adult decisions, which he doesn't have to at this point. But if I let him run the family, we're all watching Wiggles and coloring all day long, right? Probably not the best decision for our family. Be more fun, but probably not the best decision. Actually, no. I think they'll be playing Wiggles in hell. But I won't let him run the family, right? I won't let him do that. And in the same way, when it comes to us, God, we're not in charge. We don't run it. God does. We submit to him as the Lord. And we say, Jesus, you're Lord of my life. I'm going to follow after you. I'm going to surrender to you. I'm going to live for you. In verse 6 of chapter 3, it says, "And we are his house, if indeed we hold firmly to our confidence." Now, I'm going to get into theological rough waters right here when I say this next thing, right? It says, if we stand firm to the end. I want to say something to you, and I don't want you to tune me out here, because some of you I'm going to lose already. But this doesn't say that we are saved by standing firm, right? We are saved, therefore we stand firm. There's a lot of people that will argue this about, and I'm not going to tell you which side I'm on, because it really doesn't matter when it comes to everything. I mean, if you want to have a private conversation what I believe, you can ask me, but there's two sides to this camp. There's one side that says, well, once you're saved, you're always there. You don't have to worry about anything. And there's another side that says, once you're saved, you're in, you're good to go, unless you just totally reject and deny like Judas did, right? And you just totally turn. And so it's what's funny is these sides of the theological argument, there's so much arguing going over it, and they say the exact same thing. Because this side will say, well, if you did that, you never really were a Christian. And this side will say, well, you were a Christian, but then you left, you didn't do that. But ultimately, you end up in the same place. You aren't Christian in the end. Does that make a lot of sense, or did I just kind of went right over the head there? All right, so here's my point on it. There is enough evidence to see that true Christians stay faithful to the end. Doesn't mean we don't fall. Doesn't mean we don't mess up. But it means that we stay faithful and we turn back to him when we do mess up. And that's part of us staying faithful to the family, right? In Ephesians chapter 2, it says, "Consequently, you are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens with God's people and also members of his household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone." There's what we build on. We build on Jesus, right? To be in the family, we build on Jesus, his death, burial, and resurrection, and his life. And he holds the building together. And we're being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by his Spirit. Do you know, when it comes to family, people take family serious, don't they? I mean, you remember those days where people talk about your mama? Right? I mean, your mama jokes got people in fights on the playground. Right? You don't say that. You start messing. Now, you may not have the best family in the world, and you may have some things that, yeah, you can talk bad about your family, but nobody else better talk bad about your family, right? I mean, that still goes on today. And when it comes to us being part of the family, we should stand up for the family of God as well, right? It doesn't matter if the family isn't always perfect, because I want to tell you what, folks, the church isn't always perfect. The church is going to fail you. People are going to fail you that are Christian. But the thing is that you stay faithful to God and what he has called you to, and you're willing to do the things that he's called us to do within the faith. Here's an interesting part about staying faithful. Jesus puts this in the Word in 2 Timothy, where he says, here's a trustworthy saying: if we died with him, we will also live with him. If we endure, we will also reign with him. If we disown him, he will also disown us. If we are faithless, he remains faithful, for he cannot disown himself. Right? We're called to stay faithful to the family throughout. In the words of the great theologian, Don Vito Corleone, he said, a man who doesn't spend time with his family can never be a real man. And if you don't know where that's from, you're probably a better person than me, all right? And if you do know where it's from, you're like, that's a terrible accent, just shut it, all right? I'm doing this, all right? You know, when it comes to the family, there's four things I think we need to remember about staying faithful to the family. Because a real man, a real woman stays faithful to their family. We honor the head of the family, and that is Jesus. He is the head. We're told that throughout Scripture. One passage in Ephesians 5, where it says, for the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church, his body, of which he is the Savior. Right? It means he's in charge. We consider Jesus first. And it's pretty important to consider Jesus first. Jesus said some tough things throughout Scripture. There's one passage he says, which just is, a lot of people get a little weird about this passage, but I'm going to read it for you. But Matthew 10, 37 through 39, he says this: anyone who loves their father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. Anyone who loves their son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. Whoever does not take up their cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Whoever finds their life will lose it, and whoever loses their life for my sake will find it. Well, hold on, Jesus. Didn't you tell me to honor my father and mother? Didn't you tell me to take care of my kids? Didn't you tell me my spouse is important? Yes. But what Jesus is saying is, if I am truly your Lord, I am number one. If I'm truly Lord, you love me more than others. But I can't see you. I can't hug you. I can't kiss you. I can't. You put me first. You die to self and you live for me. Now, I want to tell you this. Some people say, that's a hard saying. I don't know that I can do that. Well, then you really need to surrender to the Lordship of Christ. Because I'll tell you this. If Jesus is number one, if he's up here and you love him more than others, everybody else is going to be loved better. I'm telling you, it's true. You love Jesus more than others, everybody else in your family is going to feel more love than they do right now. I promise you that. So he's the top. And then it says in Colossians 3, that you have been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on earthly things, for you died and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, that's so important, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. And we look forward to that, but we got to keep him as the head of the family. Set our hearts and our minds on him. Second thing we do in the family, we need to honor our siblings, our brothers and sisters. How many of you had brothers and sisters growing up that you fought with? Raise your hand. How many that fought with your brothers and sisters, even though you fought with them, you still love them? And if those that don't, then we have Kurt that will take counseling appointments from you afterwards. All brothers and sisters are important to the family. And Moses is a great example of this, how he lived a life. And Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians 12, just as the body, though one, has many parts, but all it forms one body, so it is with Christ. For we're all baptized by one Spirit, as to form one body. It goes on to talk about that. And it says we're all part of this, brothers and sisters in Christ. We should be loving and honoring our brothers and sisters in Christ. And just like your brothers and sisters growing up annoyed you at times, you still love them because you know that's what family does. And I want to tell you, there's people in the church that have annoyed you. There's churches that have hurt you. There's people that have hurt you in the church. And I want to say, I'm sorry for that. But that's what brothers and sisters do, unfortunately. And we got to be willing to forgive and to move on past that, right? It doesn't mean that when you forgive them that all of a sudden everything's hunky-dory and you guys are just hanging out all the time, right? That's not what that means. It means that you forgive because Jesus has called you to forgive. But we need to honor our siblings. The enemy wants us to be divided. God calls us to be united. We need to encourage them. Do you know, I do ministry with people that are in different streams of denominations than I'm in. And I don't agree with all the peripheral stuff that they believe in and different things, but I believe in the main stuff. The Bible is the Word of God, the authority in our lives, and Jesus Christ, the only way to be saved, and the indwelling of the Holy Spirit to live our lives for Him. I believe in that stuff the same. But there's other people that believe differently that I still lock arms with because I realize that's what's important. It doesn't matter if they believe differently about if I'm saved or I'm not saved, as according to once saved, always. It doesn't matter what they believe about end times. It doesn't matter some things that are so peripheral and out there. We got to stay focused on what matters, and we need to honor our siblings. Maybe today you need to ask somebody for forgiveness, or maybe you need to extend it. Third thing, we're not going to talk about this a lot because we talked a lot about it last week. As part of the family, we share with non-family. We tell them the way to get in. We tell them how to be part of the best family there ever has been or ever will be. We become a billboard for Christ, like Moses was a billboard for God. We become a billboard for Christ. In Acts 1, we're told, you'll receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you and be my witnesses in Wichita and all Sedgwick County and Kansas and the United States and to the ends of the earth. That would be in our context, right? You saw the original words. We share with non-family. And last thing is we long for the reunion. As family, we long for the reunion. Moses got to enter a rest when he was done, and so will we. If we have Jesus and we hang on and we're faithful to Jesus, we get to go to that reunion. My family didn't have family reunions growing up. I was always a little jealous of people who would travel different places and go to family reunions, and all the time they'd have those, and I'd be like, man, we don't have one. We're losers, right? No, I always was jealous of that, but you know what? Regardless of how many picnics and barbecues and vacations you've had to family reunions, and some people like them, some people don't, regardless of that, the best reunion that's ever going to happen is going to be with Him forever in heaven. And we read about it in Revelation 22. No longer will there be any curse. The throne of God and of the Lamb will be in the city, and His servants will serve Him. They will see His face, and His name will be on their foreheads. There will be no more night. They will not need the light of the lamp or the light of the sun, for the Lord God will give them light. And they will reign forever and ever. The angel said to me, these words are trustworthy and true. The Lord, the God who inspires the prophets, sent His angel to show His servants the things that must soon take place. And then we look forward to this. I mean, Jesus says, look, I'm coming soon. Blessed is the one who keeps the word of the prophecy written in the scroll. Jesus says, I'm coming soon. Be ready to be part of the most amazing family reunion ever. So make sure you're part of that family. And make sure you're faithful to the family. And you stand up for the truth of that family. Will you pray with me? God, would you help us, Lord, just to be like Moses. Lord, he was a servant who was faithful. Father, may we emulate that. May we emulate the mantra that Jesus had in that prayer in Matthew 26, not my will, but your will be done, Lord, even when it's tough. Lord, may we be faithful to the family. May we be faithful to honor Jesus as the head and honor our brothers and sisters in Christ and share with those who aren't part of the family to come into the family through the blood of Jesus. And Lord, we do long for that day you return or when we take our last breath, that we get to be part of an amazing family reunion. Help us to be faithful. We pray in Jesus' name.